What's up, everyone? I'm Sublight Drive, and today we're doing something a little different. I've got a Revell 144 scale F-19 kit, and while I build it, I'm going to tell you about how this kit for a plane that doesn't exist came to be. It's a strange tale about stealth jets, government black projects, and one Testors Corp employee who thought he had it all figured out. I've been obsessed with this story ever since I learned about it a few years ago, and by the time that I finish building this kit, I think that you'll appreciate it too. Before I can talk about the kit, though, we have to start at the beginning. The 1962 United States Tri-Service Aircraft Designation System. You see, before 1962, the US military named their aircraft based on their role and manufacturer. This worked well enough into the 1920s when there were only three manufacturers with a handful of planes each, but by the 1950s, you had something like eight different F-3s, all from different decades, and the P for pursuit planes were starting to hit the hundreds. This is on top of the fact that the different branches used their own naming schemes. The Navy might have called a plane the F-4H, but the Air Force would have called it the F-110. So, obviously, the system was in need of a little tidying up by the time that they finally got around to it in 1962. As part of that standardization, the letter prefixes were unified across all branches. So all cargo aircraft were C-somethings, all recon aircraft were R-somethings, anything that was a prototype would start with a Y, and of course, all fighter planes got to be F-somethings. All active aircraft were renamed starting at 1, with priority being given to keeping old numbers if possible. This meant that the FJ-2 became the new F-1, but the F-4 got to keep being the F-4. The F-2Y became the new F-7, and a bunch more all the way up to the F-11F, which got to keep being the F-11. Once the new system was in place, each new plane introduced was just the next number on the list. The one exception was that they decided to skip F-13 on account of it being an unlucky number. So, after the YF-12, we got the F-14 Tomcat, aka the one from Top Gun, the F-15 Eagle, the greatest air superiority fighter ever made, the F-16, which is small and pointy, the YF-17, which is the pre-production plane that later became the F-18 Hornet, the one the Navy uses, the F-20 Tiger Shark, which no one cares about, the F-21, which is just an F-16 they rebranded to sell to India, and the F-22 Raptor, which is the one that Starscream turns into nowadays. There's also the F-35 Thunderbolt, which is number 35, because it was originally the X-35. Don't worry about it. Now, the keen-eyed mathematicians among you will have probably noticed that there is one number missing from that list. There is no F-19. The official line is that Northrop, the company who developed the F-20, requested to skip 19 in order to avoid similarities to the typically odd-numbered Soviet plane designations, like the MiG-21. And if that seems like a thin justification, you're not alone, but that's for later. Next, we gotta talk about stealth technology. You see, in the 70s and 80s, the US Air Force had a big problem. Radar was getting better, IFF tech was getting better, and most importantly, missiles were getting smaller, faster, and more accurate. Put all of that together, and you get surface-to-air missiles. Vehicle-mounted, long-range, self-guiding, they could effectively close off all airspace inside of a 20-mile radius of wherever you can park a big truck. This is generally considered unpalatable by Air Force pilots and generals alike, and so there thus began a grand effort to invest in stealth tech. I won't get into the details, though obviously there's some cool science involved, but the long and short of it is that by designing planes in specific ways and using special paints or materials, you can build an aircraft that reflects way fewer radar waves than it should. So instead of showing up on a scan as something the size of an airplane, it shows up as the size of a bird, or smaller, or maybe even doesn't show up at all. This is a big change in doctrine compared to the previous stealth aircraft. Those were mostly reconnaissance planes that either used regular old camouflage, flew so high up that no one could see them, or just flew so damn fast it didn't even matter if anyone saw them because they could just outrun whatever got thrown at them. Missiles and radar were beginning to catch up with these strategies though, so capital S stealth tech was the hot new thing. Now, as can be expected, the military had an interest in keeping their newly developed stealth jets secret. In fact, they wanted to keep it really secret, like absolute denial the project even existed at all, refusing to tell Congress what they were doing with all that money, kind of secret. But it also shouldn't be too surprising that keeping that secret is really hard. And the more people that are involved, the harder it gets. Researching the technology is one thing, and even building and testing prototype planes can be done without more than a few individuals knowing, but actually constructing an entire fleet of planes and then flying them on regular combat missions around the world in complete secrecy, that's nearly impossible without somebody realizing something is going on. All of that isn't helped by the fact that stealth tech wasn't exactly unknown to the general public. In 1980, the previously secret B-2 bomber program had been announced by the Carter administration, and the basic principles of what made a plane reflect more or less radar had been public information since at least the 1960s. So, by the mid-80s, it was understood that the US military was developing a top-secret stealth jet, even if the details were obscure. And, in case you forgot, there was no fighter jet with the F-19 designation, for apparently no reason. You don't need to be a Soviet operative to put two and two together on that one, and a lot of people made the obvious assumption. The F-19 must be the United States' ultra-classified stealth plane. But this isn't a story about spycraft, or science, or even really about airplanes. This is a story about a model kit. Which brings us to Testors. Today, Testor sells mostly paint and glue, but in 1985, they had a pretty sizable model kit division. At that time, John Andrews was a kit designer at Testors. Andrews was an industry insider. He had contacts in the DoD, the aerospace industry, and the armed forces proper. He'd been a designer at Testors for decades and was extremely familiar with the technology used in less classified military planes. One day, his boss, a man named Gary Kadish, happened to see a few drawings of a stealth jet he'd done for an unrelated project. When Kadish asked Andrews if something like that was actually flying, he said, "Oh yeah, of course, but you know, this is just a sketch, not the real thing." Then Kadish asked if he could recreate what the real F-19 was really like, and Andrews was confident that he could do it. So confident, in fact, that he claimed he could come up with one that was 90% accurate to the real craft, even though no images of it had ever been released to the public. Kadish was convinced, and he pitched it to the higher-ups at Testors. It took some cajoling to get it approved, but it probably helped that Andrews was so self-assured in his abilities. In fact, once the project was okayed, they actually held meetings to determine if there was a risk of revealing secrets to the Soviets. They decided that there wasn't. The kit that you're watching me build right now is Andrews' design, or near enough to it. The shape of it is vaguely reminiscent of an SR-71, but sleeker, more rounded. It's mysterious and sci-fi looking, but also, despite Andrew's insistence to the contrary, entirely fictional. All the same, Testors put them out for sale, along with the rest of their new products from 1986, and they got more or less ignored in favor of the F-14 kit, which was everyone's favorite on account of Top Gun just came out that year. Or at least they were ignored until a newspaper reporter in Ohio walked into his local model shop and said, "Hey, what the hell?" That reporter, Tim Gaffney, then went and wrote an article in the Dayton Journal-Herald pointing out how odd it was that Testors was selling a model kit for an airplane that, according to the US military, did not exist. The Associated Press caught wind, and with that, a media frenzy began, with Testors Corp right at the center. Testors were in the headlines across the country. CBS sent a film crew to shoot footage of the production lines. The kit was featured on the evening news with Dan Rather. At one point, US Congressman Ron Wyden stood in front of the House of Representatives waving the kit in his hand, asking why he was able to buy and build a model of a jet that he, a member of the House, wasn't allowed to see in real life. Then, in 1986, when a military plane crashed outside of Bakersfield, California, the crash site was immediately cordoned off by soldiers and circling helicopters. Despite the Air Force's insistence to the contrary, it was clearly a mishap with one of their new stealth jets. And when the story went to air, the image that ran with it was Andrews' F-19. As far as anyone was concerned, Andrews' design was the top-secret stealth jet. F-19s featured in Tom Clancy's Red Storm Rising, there was an F-19 video game, even G.I. Joe and Transformers got in on the action. The kit I'm building right now isn't an original Testors kit, though I have built one of those. This is Revell's version of the F-19, which has a few small differences, mainly the canards along the front are a different shape and placement. I have no idea how the rights shake out in a situation like this, but since it was assumed the F-19 was a real plane, I got to imagine that anyone who wanted could take a crack at it. Regardless of who else was selling F-19s, though, Testors were the real winners. Their original production run of 100,000 units had to be increased to 6 times that to meet demand. Andrews' F-19 commanded the media storm as the best-selling model kit of all time, beating out AMT's Enterprise kit. I've also built one of those, if you're curious. And then, just 2 years later, the Air Force decided to reveal the actual stealth jet. If you're watching my channel, I probably don't need to tell you that the supposed F-19 was actually the F-117 Nighthawk. So Andrews' design was pretty far from the mark, but you really can't blame him for it. No one could have predicted it would look like that. God, it's weird looking. Less like an airplane and more like the offspring of a low-poly bat and a broken umbrella. Like a Juan Gris painting of a weird shoe. They look like pyramid-themed bad guys in a PlayStation 1 game. Anyway. In Andrew's defense, he was right about a few things, like the type of engines used, the rough size of the thing, and even the shape of the nose cone, which was a part that he'd managed to get real insider info on. As for why it's the F-117 and not the 19, I've read a few different stories, but the most well-supported one is this. The Air Force, when they were testing captured Soviet planes, used F-11-something designations to disguise what they were actually flying. Since the Nighthawk was flown out of the same base as the Soviet planes, it got the next number on the list, and the name stuck. What makes things more confusing is that the F-117 shouldn't really be an F-4 fighter jet at all. Its role is a ground attack plane, which means it ought to be the A-17, or at least the A-something, but I'm getting distracted. Testors did release a kit of the real stealth jet once the F-117 was made public, but of course, it didn't sell as well as the F-19. The C-suite were still high on their unexpected windfall, though, and wanted to recapture that success. So they started releasing more top-secret designs of speculative aircraft. First with a Soviet counterpart to the F-19 and then a stealth helicopter, which, while their version looks pretty stupid, is at least a real thing. But next was a model of the Aurora program aircraft, the rumored and non-existent hypersonic successor to the SR-71. After that, they moved on to less credible designs. In a team-up with UFO conspiracy darling Bob Lazar, they made a kit of one of the anti-gravity flying saucers that Lazar said he worked on at Area 51. And if that wasn't good enough for you, they also had a kit for the alien spaceship it was reverse engineered from. Predictably, none of these kits sold nearly as well as the F-19. In the end, I think there just wasn't any demand for kits like these. They exist in limbo, not really toys, but not serious business scale model kits either. They're totally fictional, but presented as if they were real, and not very convincingly. The original F-19 kit was lightning in a bottle, arriving at the perfect time to enrapture an American audience that was primed to believe in it by the actual government conspiracies that were happening around them. By the late 90s, Testors had significantly slowed down their model kit division, and almost entirely stopped producing planes. They put out a few more kits through the 2000s, but by 2012 they'd pretty much called it quits. They still exist today, of course, but only as a brand name for glues and paints and stuff, no models. I wouldn't say that betting so hard on top secret designs is what killed their model division, but it certainly didn't help. It's too bad, too, because there's clearly a market for sci-fi models. I don't think that advertising them as real, ultra-classified government projects would go over well today, but alternate history or what-if military designs would fit right in besides Machine and Krieger or other mecha kits just fine. This little model and the other F-19 I built are... they're not good kits. The tooling is rough, the fits are bad, all the parts have flash, but I've got such a soft spot for them. They're something weird, something different. Design that was everywhere for those 2 years between 86 and 88, where everyone knew the F-19 was real, and then completely forgotten once the F-117 was unveiled. It's a relic of such a short, specific time, like a layer in the geologic strata of American history. Oh, and why did they actually skip over the number 19? Well, there's no good answer. The only official line is what I mentioned at the beginning, about avoiding the similarities to Soviet planes. My personal theory is that because the F-20 was meant to be sold to US allies, some higher up in Northrop thought that 20 was a more marketable number than 19, not that it worked. We'll probably never know the real reason, though. And with that, I'm just about done building this tiny little piece of model-making history. This video was a little different than my usual content, so if you liked it, you should leave a comment letting me know. I had half a mind to make this a 10,000 subscriber special, but I don't know if I'm gonna quite hit that mark by the time this video comes out. Maybe we'll call it a pre-10K special? If it goes over well, I think it could be fun to do more model-making history videos, though I'll have to do some digging to find a story that matches the sheer entertainment value of this one. If you made it all the way to the end here, thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time. Like someone who'd only ever heard a description of an airplane tried to build one out of plywood. Like the first time I tried to make an origami frog, but goth. Like a child's drawing of a collapsed tent, but goth. They had a budget of $2.5 billion and 23 polygons. Like somebody screwed up gift wrapping an actual airplane. It has bunny ears. I'd say it looks like an alien spaceship, but only because they copped the design from Starglider 2 for the ZX Spectrum. But goth.